on marketing and ad technology, creating opportunities in great gaming. We would like to begin by thanking all of you for being a part of Gator 2021, the next leap. We would like to also thank our title partner, Games 24/7, powered by AppsFlyer, in association with Jackia, Platinum Partner OnePlus, Content Delivery Partner Limelight Networks, and we're supported by Invest India and our knowledge partners, Zedseo. Without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce to you Mr. Rohit Verma, co-founder of Jackia, who will moderate today's discussion. And joining us today, we have a set of distinguished leaders, Mr. Arvind Nair, Director, Miram India, Mr. Mitesh Gangar, co-founder and director, PlayerSpot Media Private Limited, Mr. Devashish Bhattacharya, co-founder and CMO, Pocket 52, and Mr. Abhinandan Balasubramanian, co-founder, X1 Racing and board member, GG1 or Good Game 1. I would request all delegates to please post their questions in the chat box, and the panel will address a few selected at the end of the session if they have the time. And with that, over to you, Mr. Udit.
Thank you. Thanks for the introduction. Hello, everyone. I am Udit Verma, co-founder and CMO at Trackia.com. Trackia is an attribution technology for mobile apps and websites. So the topic of this discussion is marketing and advertising technology, creating opportunity in gaming. So to discuss this, today we have our wonderful panelist, Mr. Arvind Nair, director of Miram India, Mr. Devashish Bhattacharya, co-founder and CMO at Pocket 52, Mr. Mitesh Gangar, co-founder and director of PlayerSpot, Mr. Abhinandan Balasubramanian, co-founder at X1 Racing and board gaming Good Game 1. Yeah. So I would like our panelists to introduce themselves. So starting with Arvind, please take your
own. Thanks, Udit. Thanks, Udit. So hi, everybody who's watching. My name is Arvind. I lead growth and strategy for Miram in India. So we've been working with a lot of brands across different technologies, verticals, etc. And gaming has been one of the key elements that we've recommended to some of them over a course of time. Specifically, there are certain brands that have more inclination depending on the kind of audiences that they work with, and the others are still averse to the gaming world and how to invest and advertise in the game. So hopefully in the course of the conversation we'll sort of cover some of those points. Thanks.
Please, Mitesh, can you hear me?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Thanks, Udit. So I'm Mitesh Gangar and co-founder director of PlayerSpot. PlayerSpot has started its journey with the fantasy gaming. In fantasy gaming, we have covered across 9 sports. And now, from last year, we have ventured out with other real money casual segments, gaming segment. In this session, we would be covering great aspects like how PlayerSpot has achieved his journey through marketing and different other aspects for the user acquisition and user retention.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for the wonderful question. Devashish, please.
Yeah, I am Devashish, founder of one of the most exciting esports iGaming company, Pocket 52, India's largest poker network and among world's top 20. It's based out of Bangalore. And we have been doing poker, like recently introduced Rummy, as well as Call Break. So all game of skills, like.
Wonderful. Abhinandan, please.
Thanks for having me, guys. I'm Abhinandan, co-founder of Good Game 1. We are a digital media network for all things gaming. And when I mean by that, we create content around the theme, lifestyle, and culture of gaming, which includes esports competitions in competitive games such as Call of Duty, FIFA, PUBG, and the likes, and create original content, including talk shows and web shows in the theme of gaming. So that's me. I also am a board member of Racing Promotions, which is the promoter of Formula 3 and Formula 4 in India, and the Indian Racing League.
Yeah, thanks a lot. So the visitor who are visiting this event, you can drop the question into the chat box. We can take the question after the session. So, guys, my first question is, what potential does the gaming industry hold for the advertisers? Starting from Devashish.
Okay. See, I'll tell you, I think both are very synonymous in a way, like because both of us have a very important role to play. I'll try to answer this question with a bent of responsible gaming. What you make and how you market is very important, and who is the market. So these are the three things overall. We have been doing very good. Like, I think like all my peers, like MPL, Dream 11, and many others of sorts, like PlayerSpot for that example, like we are responsibly very conscious. We are seeing how people are reacting to this new thing. I think it's a new thing, but advertisers and advertisement have become very, very witty, clever, and towards the beneficial like of people. I think targeting is one of the most important topics. I think we'll cover it up in the next set of questions, but yeah, I think like together it's a good combination of Miss India plus Mother India, you know, like that's how I would like coin this.
Who's the Miss India?
I think I would say like real money gaming should be the Miss India, because we are a sunrise sector. We have just evolved out of the park. When we were going to our colleges, carrying our bags, everybody wanted to do something in gaming, you know, some course in something in gaming or something. When we were playing those IGI2 days, you know, for the first time, Bullet was used by using real physics. We were all excited. And now it's in our hand in India, you know, Zapark, like they took it to the next level. It's in our hand. So it's an incredible time for us. So it's a sunrise sector, and I don't see any eclipse as of now.
Yeah, definitely. So Mitesh, what's your views on that? So Mitesh is also from the fantasy game. So I think Mitesh is having some more insights about that.
Yeah, sure. So I agree with Devashish, and a very good example of Miss India and Mother India. I would go one step ahead, and I said it goes hand in hand for the advertisers and for the gaming industry. So in like past few years, due to digital digitization of everything and the mobile being very handy and the data being cheap, so the advertisers also had innovated themselves and reached to a certain point where everything can be tracked, and it helps the gaming industry to identify the potential users, and it helps in personification, it helps in segmentation. So yes, a very, very important hand in hand leap of a gaming industry as well as for the advertisements.
So Abhinandan, what's your take on that?
Yeah, I think the gaming industry offers, you know, potential to target customers who otherwise have been very difficult to reach for advertisers and marketers traditionally, and it's also sort of the timing around it. The pandemic has made it more mainstream. Before that, I think gaming is like the echo chamber example of golf. You know, the guys who play golf or the guys who watch golf, and but gaming came out of that during the pandemic. Now you have everyone who sort of dabbles in some kind of gaming, be it, I don't know, a Ludo or a Fruit Slash, to playing PUBG or Free Fire or Call of Duty, to, you know, playing skill-based gaming online like a poker, etc. I think that audience, which is, and they're engaging for a lot longer than traditional television audiences. And that's something that, you know, is something that marketers can sort of capture and get real sort of engagement, real sort of ROI for every buck that is being invested. Exciting times for everyone overall. I think for us, very specifically at Good Game One, we've been focused in how do we nurture and structure the Generation Z target segment in a way to sort of hand that over to people who want to sort of reach out and engage with them. And that's also a constant problem, because these guys have the Gen Z have like multiple requirements, and they, you know, pretty much play to their stereotype. They have very short attention span and things like that. So you need to sort of start creating things that becomes valuable for them to engage with. And I think over time, you know, us and a bunch of other companies will be able to sort of do this.
So, like, I think for me, if I think in, like, with the advertiser perspective, esports plays an important role for that. Like, I'm a big fan of cricket. Like, I play cricket. I think I started playing cricket esports, like cricket as a sport, in 2009. That was a bit late. So I think I saw one advertisement of hotels.com. So that like I was just making one flight. I was just making some purchase on Make My Trip. I saw the advertisement. I just booked the hotel from the hotels.com. So that was the impact that advertiser can create from the gaming industry. If I talk about the esports market. So yeah, Arvind, what's your take?
I think all of these guys have sort of laid the foundation for it and called me Mother India as well. So I would just say that, the way I see it, it's a 100 billion global industry, right? When you have a 100 billion global industry, it's driven by where you have consumers, you have brands, and where you have brands, you have marketing and advertising. Now, the challenge that I see, while there is a great rosy picture, the challenge that I see, and you know, that's something that we can keep looking at, is that an average gamer is probably the most evolved, user within their friend circle or somewhat. So, you know, you're typically the top of the pyramid, as you call them, in the pyramid of education. Now, those are naturally, you are subverting advertisements. You know, you don't want advertisements to be part of your journey mostly. So the challenge that throws to this industry, which is coming together between marketing and gaming, is how do you build in those experiences within your gaming experience? So rather than intruding into somebody, is it possible that we create more experiences? And I think that's also that's something that while Fortnite does globally pretty well, I think there are opportunities where brands, agencies and gaming companies need to come together and collaborate and bring that out. I think that those are elements that I think we are still at the very nascent stage, but the growth has happened in the last few years tremendously. So that's my sense of it. We work with a lot of brands where we do recommend gaming as a right opportunity for them to advertise and talk to the potential customers. But we just find gamers are really elusive, and they really understand when to not look at ads and when to look at ads when they are running out of credit and they want to see that ad for 5 seconds. But it's with the mindset that I'm looking at it so that I get a free credit. That's my perspective. I think it's a blue ocean.
So I think Devashish just mentioned about the targeting. So I think in gaming sector, the customer plays huge role. So how do you use the advertising technology to build a relationship with your users to games? So, Devashish.
Yeah, sure. I'll have to start from somewhere. Like, I'm thinking, because we have been doing it from last 3.5 years. Every time it has evolved. Somewhere it has been advertisers, somewhere it has been publishers. But more or less, like I'll say you from this perspective, that ready-made solutions are mostly given from the affiliate side itself. Like if you talk about, like, you don't know an apps flyer of the days or a trackier of the days or a branch of the days, you know, like you are a CMO of 1997 Pepsi who is looking for a CPC at some bizarre number or something like that. That is one thing to start with. The other thing is that, like, I think I'm working very closely with Trackier. Like, I have integrated that particular platform. Udit, your team has been fantastic. Like, with that experience, I can tell you that, there is a good amount of evolution that needs to take place. And I'll go one more step, like, saying, in the lines of Abhinandan, what you mentioned, you know, every game is different. For example, if I tell you, if you were to play Rummy, all the high-stake players, like all the VIP customers and all the mid-segment or the low-segment would come down and play Rummy on an app, on an iOS app or in an Android app. In poker, it is more diversified. You know, you have a desktop app, you have it's in Mac, it's in Windows. So as of now, globally, there is no solution for Windows, you know. 10 years back, everything has been, like, resolved, like, that there will be no more tracking. So these are the places I think, like companies like AppsFlyer, or like AppsFlyer is not even in the web, like they are completely on the app section. Like Branch and Trackier, like these are my feedback that they need to evolve over a period of time to understand every game in a different way. For example, I use CleverTap for my retention, but I know very well that CleverTap is more of an e-commerce tool. It's not made for gaming. So if you try to scale CleverTap throughout the entire day, the entire SaaS will hang up. So I have no grievance with CleverTap, but it is actually made for the e-commerce industry. So you will have to build your own CRM in your gaming ecosystem, because you're resilient by force, not by choice. So these are the kind of things that we come across every day. On top of that, the fraud has always been evolving. Amazon was one of the pioneers. They instituted GAID and so many other things. And of course, many other companies are coming with many great things. But largely speaking, from my experience, most of them are not in India. Even if they are, for advertisers, India is a tier 3 country when it comes down to spends and many other things. So that's where the differentiation comes in. And we, as a country, we are called like, we can provide a good amount of quantity, you know. And as Stalin had mentioned once, you know, like quantity has a quality of its own. So we are doing that. The moment we get down to the quality of it and more users come in, like with more money, I think this thief police thing like this will keep on evolving over a period of time. So that's my perspective of giving an answer to this particular question. I know I've not given a direct answer, but I've tried touching a lot of different perspectives here.
Yeah, I think as you mentioned that about the attribution technology needs to be evolved. So yeah, we are at the verge of like integrating something ad tech with a mark tech, because so that can be a.
You know, I think also I think there is also a large amount of education that needs to happen on the marketing side. You know, what I feel which is missing, at least coming from the industry, is that we were talking backstage about, you know, I've been a gamer since I've been a kid, and so on and so forth. But a lot of people do not understand the kind of audience types that you can really attract, and the kind of opportunities that gaming really allows for marketers or brands. And if you look at digital and advertising, that space itself is very new in India. I mean, we are barely 10, 15 years old. So it's all nascent stage, right? I mean, nothing's really like engraved in stone, like a TV ad or a print ad, right? It's all evolving. So in that space, I think there is also a lot of huge opportunity to educate a lot of these brands and marketing teams on the potential opportunities. Because I don't think, you know, while publishers, et cetera, and technologies, et cetera, do a certain amount of job, they actually sell audiences, they sell interest.
Mm.
But, you know, if you collaborate directly with a brand, for example, the kind of innovation that you can probably come out is probably a much stronger branded experience that you can co-create with them. So I think that's an opportunity that still lies untapped, is how at least I see it.
To add on to Arvind, I have a very interesting thing, you know, like a few days back we were discussing it out, that all of us like sitting here, all the founders, co-founders and other emissaries, like we have ourselves not only evolved as gamers, but come out of that pirated thing, you know, like we used to make those assembled PCs, like pirated games from torrents. I have downloaded myself.
Yeah.
From there to going into going on to games, then in-app purchases, then purchases, deposits, you know. So the wallet is getting a little thicker and pocket is becoming a little deeper. So the more it happens, like you will see more users coming up. As on date, I will still say it's a tier 3 country for advertisers, and like we are a quantity based country, you know, we are a clickbait system. So anybody from tier 1 country needs some clicks. Welcome to India. Take the traffic there.
Yeah, so Mitesh, wow, what's your thought on the potential of gaming industry for the times?
So potential for MarTech and AdTech for gaming is not yet actually explored, as mentioned by Debashish and Arvind. So it's going to be huge, and still, what we are figuring as a gaming industry, what we are relying is only on the user acquisition and the user retention part. But still, there is so much of synchronization nowadays available. To target a user, much direct potential target is still not available, which can be like evolved in a period of days, and based on the user's history, user segmentation of using certain apps, and then probably advertising them, showcasing the advertise of such segments based on the different segments they use. So you can identify the potential customers, Devashish said, that the spending capacity of the user. So day by day, the spending capacity, we are also seeing, like from the last 4 years, we are seeing the every year we are seeing the average spends of the user has been increasing every year on year. And it's not only based on the new customer, but the old customers are also like spending right now, which they were not used to spend before. So before they were be using the only the pay to play, but due to the advertisements and due to the portrayal of the gaming as a legal thing and as a good to opt for entertainment, people are nowadays trying to spend much more and utilizing their time to win some amount, just not only playing passively but actively. So potential is there, but I'll still consider there's a great evolvement till now. It's been done and it's helping the gaming industry today also.
I feel like Dream 11 plays an important role to increase the fantasy sport in India. It's amazing.
They grow the categories.
It's amazing how they how they have grown from just an APK ad campaign.
Correct. It was a completely different campaign. People used to understand to download from the Play Store, but from the website to download a APK was not considered as a good thing, and it was something spyware will be coming to your phone or something else. So, but nowadays, people do believe that it coming from a valuable source, and so the trend has been changing, and so Dream 11 is a pioneer of the fantasy sports, and maybe somewhere for the real money segment also.
I think player sport will play a different role in coming years.
Maybe, yeah.
So Abhinandan,
certainly.
Yeah, Abhinandan, what's your take?
Yeah, I think the real money gaming and fantasy, I'll probably leave it to Debashish and Mitesh. But I think Arvind made a interesting point about gaming being at the intersection of multiple other cultures, right? Like music, fashion, lifestyle. And you see these music concerts happening within the Fortnite metaverse, and that's where I think you'll see the future, right? As the world kind of goes towards that, where physical experiences and possession and assets are replaced with everything digital, we are big believers in that. We think that the big chunk of our target audience, which is the Gen Z and to a certain extent the millennials, are all going to prefer that kind of experience going forward. And to that, I mean, we have to cater to those needs and wants of people. And I think by bringing that bringing all of that together is how you can create value as well for potential marketers. Because then you're not only impacting just one kind of demographic, but you're creating that avenue for everyone else to get involved in that space as well. That's really where the chunk of the pie is gonna be. And again, this is an overabuse comparison in the media industry, but specifically in the sports media industry. But if you look at traditional sports like cricket, football, they have not only succeeded on the sport itself, they have succeeded on the entertainment aspect of it. And I think that intersection with media is very important for us to deliver the real value for advertisers.
Yeah, I think Abhinandan, as you are in esports, I have one question. How the advertisers attribute the ROI for that that branding campaign. So suppose I saw one, as I told you that, saw one hotel.com advertisement on cricket 2019. So how they attribute that ad?
I think it's still very largely dominated by the endemic brands, because they can cross sell a bunch of their products and services to the gamer. And I would go so far to say I think 75-80% of the market is them, and the other 20% of the non-endemics are really sort of only exploring and venturing into this to sort of see who these guys are, you know. And here, I mean, you're not sort of looking at CPCs and CPMs, because scientifically that doesn't work in the space, and anyone expecting that is never going to be convinced and return with higher premiums, right? So I think how we've addressed that is sort of creating these packages, creating these experiences / activations for brands, as opposed to sort of, you know, a pure play advertising deliverable, and also because, you know, as a third party operator into the industry where we don't own the game. I mean, the publisher at the end of the day owns the game. We have to sort of be, you know, in line with their rules and regulations and how we sort of are able to present that package. That and of course, in certain cases, there have been deep integrations where we've had in-game ads, but these are very far and few between. So there in the lack of native ads and any support for native ads or in-game advertisements, I think it's more about sort of traditional packaging, like pretty much how we put it in quotes, right? And that's one of the things that we are doing at Good Game One, which is sort of implementing the sports framework into esports, so as to speak. There's definitely a need for that. Otherwise, I mean, you're not seeing the 5, 10, 20x premiums because it's largely dominated by the endemics, and they're happy sort of, you know, going in early and sort of setting that benchmark very low and just doing the 5-10% increment, which by itself cannot sustain the industry, because the kind of investments organizers and people that are running tournaments are doing, it's quite massive. I mean, you have guys who are doing 25, 50 lakh on average prize pool tournaments. So for you to sort of, you know, build that in a sustainable and holistic manner, I think it has to move away from sort of CPC, CPMs, and the more holistic packaging approach.
In fact, just to add to what Abhinandan just mentioned, right, the whole attribution model about branding and in-stadium branding or wherever it is, I mean, in his case, it's esports, but even if you compare with cricket or football or anything, the attribution model today does not exist, because it's the number of times I see it on the screen, flashing on the TV screen. Now that's not attributable to people. That's just the number of times that that boundary wall or wherever that board is has come. And when you're in stadium, you're pretty much facing sort of, you know, you're not seeing all the ads at the same time. So it's a gray area, I don't think, and he's absolutely right. It's not a CPM. Marketers need to sort of think a different.
I think that can be like converted into the remarketing campaign. If you saw the like the ads, then you can retarget that person like after that.
But how do you see it on a live cricket match? You can't retarget. I can't retarget you if you've seen hotels.com banner in a live cricket match to you, right? I can target you if you've seen the live cricket match.
We can think about it. I can have a separate discussion with you
for that. Cool.
So Arvind, I have something to add here. Like, I forgot the name of the company. Very recently, they were funded by Disney, I believe. Like, and they came up with a very interesting solution, and they told us, look, like, we can get into people's, like, deeper into people, like, you know, deeper into your TG. And I say, okay, how is it? So some of the scenarios were as such, like, you know, that somebody who has a phone sitting in his, sitting in a couch, watching a cricket match very lavishly, like has a phone close by, watching a match, cricket match. Then there is an advertisement that flashes, you know, that go Ibibo for that example. Take a flight 3 days after, get a discount of that particular thing, you know. And he has an option to skip that ad or maybe anything. Maybe he's watching in his like television or something. He can skip it.
Right.
If he's consuming that ad and that ad is for 30 seconds, if he's consuming that ad for 20 seconds, let's say, because during advertisement, either you will skip the ad if you have the provision, or you will switch the channel. You can watch something else during the breaks. If he's watching for, if the duration of the ad is 30 seconds, and if he's watching it more than 15 seconds, that company has its SDK embedded into a lot of different apps which is in your phone.
I know this. And so, you become a cookie pool. But no, but what I was saying here was not the ad flashing in between. I was talking about the ads behind the boundaries, right? That you see.
Okay.
Yeah. Which are static, right? Like that's what Abhinandan was saying, that you know, you know, when you're playing an esport, there is a banner at the back that says hotels.com, for example. Now that's just in-stadia branding. Now that in-stadia branding, there is no measurement on how many times you've seen or I've seen.
But on that as well, like I met a German guy who had come to meet me from Singapore. He told me that you can sponsor a football match and based on your region or your location, whatever set of people like subscribe to a certain channel or something, we can target those ads based on that. So that could be one of a kind in a football match as a solution that he had told me.
I think in the Euro, they did something which was programmatic. It was programmatic display, programmatic TV ad or something they called it, where each region saw different ad behind that big digital billboard in a live game. So I think that probably is another way to look at it, because that if that technology is available on TV, you guys can probably have that for different ad segments. You can have common space running different ads or something like that.
So taking on this one such opportunity we had was during the women's tournament, India went to England. Indian women team went to the England. So England cricket board has presented at the perimeter boards on the boundary. So you can, if you are in India, you can display it only for the India, and for the other region, it will be displayed for some other. So such are the offline events are still getting into the online advertisements, and retargeting is possible.
But I think that might not be the accurate one. We can just have some kind of idea about that because of the attribution windows.
Yeah, we can all agree to disagree or disagree to agree. Move on to the next interesting question.
It's an evolving space. You talk
later. Yeah, I'll get back to you.
I'll get back to you after this. So, guys, how does ad tech and mark tech help you in taking your monetization to the next level? So I think you guys are like running some amazing campaigns, and I think you guys are making some more money these days because of IPL and the cricket. Like
very subtle.
So, how does AdTech and MarkTech is helping you like to realize your monetization?
Yeah, I would like to hear Abhinandan first if I request him.
So, I think, with Good Game One, we are quite early in our journey. We are doing a sort of pre-launch phase with a select set of colleges. So we did our first competition with one of the 7 colleges which span July, August. And we are taking a very different approach to gaming as opposed to a lot of the other esports organizers and tournament organizers. I think where we are coming from is if this sort of category is going to be built out to create massive value for all the stakeholders. I'm not just talking about the players and the publishers, but also for people who are invested in the ecosystem. We strongly think, there needs to be a talent pipeline. And again, just going back to what I was referring to earlier, and because I have the background in sports, I've launched 2 sports leagues. One of the important things that we decided to do early on was to sort of say, how do we build out in a very structured manner more talent that can come into this and legitimize this ecosystem? Because I think, whatever said and done, within the gaming industry and within the esports world, we all keep talking about this $3 million prize pool that the 16-year-old wins in Fortnite, or $1 million prize pool that a Call of Duty team wins, which is bigger than the US Open and the winners of whatever, the Indy 500. But that again is the echo chamber, right? It's still the guys who are gaming who are talking about it. There's if you talk to a mother, father of a non-gamer or anyone who's not been touched by the industry, they don't really or necessarily know about these facts. So what we decided very early on was to sort of structure this ecosystem and go into school, into collegiate esports as the route to sort of create value for the community and for the publishers. And I don't know why Devashish put it to me, but then that itself is not a big money maker. And we knew that from day one, right? We are not dealing with the top 1% of, and I'll draw a parallel to, let's say, cricket, you know, just for the ease of the audience to understand this. We are not doing the IPL. We are focused in the state, school, college cricket. You know, that's what we are doing for esports. And we believe in creating the next generation of superstars as opposed to sort of, you know, empower the already empowered. Multiple reasons for that. Also, we believe in the long run, there needs to be someone who is able to create value for the grassroots and have a big portion of it. And look at monetization as a means probably 3 years down the line when we sort of go completely native and have a platform where people come in and compete, etc.
Some background.
Yeah.
Background noises.
I think that, you know, with what we're doing, in the early days, for now, we are only focusing on sponsorship and digital rights as the means to monetize. And that's with a very few select brands that understand the space and others who are able to sort of see the packaging that we are doing. We're not just running contests. We are not in the business of contests. We don't ask people to pay to play. Rather, they get paid huge sums of money. So, for instance, our first pilot program with 107 colleges, we dispersed a 5 lakh prize pool, which is a significant amount of money for college kids. And along with that, you know, we're doing a bunch of music nights where we have DJs coming in and performing and things like that. So we are really, you know, a digital network at the intersection of gaming, lifestyle, music. And that's how we want to build it out. And, you know, to answer your question very specifically, our monetization model is completely driven by sponsors and distributors at this point in time. We are not in the game of native advertising or sort of implementing ad tech at this point. But that is where we want to get to. And that will only happen when there's more science to this method in our country. At this point in time, we don't think it is the most relevant way to sort of bring in brands into the ecosystem.
Perfect. So, Mitesh, what's your view? I think Mitesh calls freezed.
Okay. Hello.
Let's start with like Devashish. Devashish, what do you think?
Okay, Mitesh is frozen, right? Yeah. I think like it's a very difficult question to answer, you know. Like, I still believe we are in 1997 in India with regards to advertisements. MarTech and AdTech, I would say like market tend to focus on nurturing prospects through social media, SEO, email and so on, you know. And AdTech meanwhile is more about paid media, buying the right spot. And right inventory to get content in front of eyeballs. So more or less, if I put this as a perspective, I would rather say that ad tech has more to do with DMPs or the DSPs or the SSPs of the world. You know, MarTech is more to do with the trackers of the world, like, you know, the clever taps of the world or any Salesforce CRM you talk about, something like that. So again, I would most for a DMP perspective, like 2015, when Adobe had evolved as a DMP, like until now, I don't see any other technologies apart from that working so transparently in India. So a lot of things to happen as of now. Like, personally, me, there are a lot of companies who come in and get in touch with me, but I haven't touched upon all of them. So it would be not a complete answer from my side, but I still believe there is a good amount of synergy that needs to take place, you know, like it's the marketing and the consumer as of now, because I'm just deviating from the question a bit, because even if you see not the government, but the governance, you know, they have come up with one line as per ASCII that, okay, it's your responsibility and you're watching that and you put the disclaimer below, you know, does it changes anything? Like 1999 World Cup was, 96 World Cup was sponsored by Wills. ITC group, you know, everybody was wearing a Wills. So there are a lot of learning that needs to even happen at a professional level, not at a government level. To give you an example, I'll tell you, you can run ads on Facebook for Rummy. You cannot run ads for poker in Facebook. So I have poker and rummy both, you know. So that's a great part. So sometimes they would allow me to run apps for rummy, then they would not, then they would, and then they would not. For poker, they have asked me for a document which is yet not known by the central government of India. So everybody's figuring it out, like how to get it done for poker. Same hide and seek happens for Google. So before the ad tech and the martech stitching or the culmination would happen, I think like compliances wise, we need to be more streamlined for government per se, or the big companies where you are, who are supposed to take all your money, right? Google and Facebook. They want to take all your money and give you good customers. So that needs to take place in the first case. Then only we can go more deeper into these realms.
Okay. Mitesh, like, I think you got dropped. So yeah. What's your views on like ad tech, mark tech,
I'm audible now?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah. So EdTech and MarTech are like currently, like, we are only dependent on the user acquisition and retargeting itself. Rest all things are like internally developed by our own system. So like we want something, some solutions that need to be came up from this technology, so that like we can focus on our gameplays and our own platforms. So that like just to give an example, like we can get a trend from CleverTap, but to utilize that trend, we need to like develop a profile itself. We need to market ourselves. We need to do the profilification, user segmentation on. So like, there's an ample amount of opportunity still available, like for the involvement for the MarTech and EdTech, that they can come up with such solutions and we can directly integrate with them. And like our times is also saved, and like more audience reach we can do based on the retargeting and to reach to a correct audience. So basically, like yeah, that's the thing. Like.
So I think, how do you look for a like powerful attribution solution for the like for PlayStation?
So basically, like we are currently enabled with the CleverTap and Google Analytics. So like we take the data from there and we like do dump it somewhere else, and we do the AI on that, and then we identify our own users, and like. From the click base, from the affiliate marketing, we take the data from there, we dump it over there, and we like find out certain users, and we do the marketing in our own self. So like there's opportunity available with others also, like if they can merge the platforms and merge the different apps data and pull it over there, and like they can do the any marketing advertising tool can do come up with such solutions, it will be much more easier for us, and like we'll be much more focusing on the gaming itself and like not entering into the customer's profilifications.
So Arvind, like what do you think about the ad tech, mark tech, like
any other tech? To add like any other tech, like with MarTech and AdTech, you know.
No, so I mean, I have a little, I'm a little purist when it comes to marketing. So my view to this is a little different. I mean, while I agree with everybody about the need of evolution of both MarTech and AdTech, I think it's not at the stage where it should be, specifically when it comes to gaming. And you know, that I think also, again, I'm coming back to the initial point that I'd made, that I don't think brands really understand gaming as a marketing vehicle yet. You know, they just go by what ad tech sells them or publisher sells them, and that's why you keep looking at attribution data and etc. Whereas when we really, I mean, I really feel that the power of the gaming and marketing sort of today lies is the ability to have different types of audiences and the access to different types of audiences. And where this comes from is like my 70-year-old mother spent about 2 hours every day just playing games on her phone. And I was telling this backstage. Now for a lot of marketers, that will not even be an audience segment that they would think would be available through gaming. because that is somebody who's 70 plus years, woman. You know, she's been a housewife most of her life. She sits at, and she's just gaming through the day. So there are opportunities for brands, and there are opportunities for us to look at it. But when that goes to a brand, it goes as a big audience pool as part of an ad tech platform or a programmatic output, right? Now I think that segmentation, those basic conversations, those learnings, etc., really need to get translated very well into the marketing schemes, the way marketing mix is looked at. Because I think that's where, I mean, like what Abhinandan was saying earlier, I probably agree with him a little more that initially right now, I think if I was to go and recommend something to brands, it would rather be like a sponsorship versus, you know, go through like an affiliate or a network and push that through. Because I think that at least gives me the fact that, hey, listen, you're the sponsor of the event. You get the eyeballs, you get, and that's your ROI. I mean, you know, you go by purely from the means of awareness, purely go by the means of the kind of voice that you make. So, I mean, that's personally my contrarian view. I mean, that's like I said, I come from a purist marketing mind. So that's my view on it.
Yeah, now I can see Yash on the screen. So I think it's a time to wrap up. So thanks a lot, guys. Thanks for your like time.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Thank you, guys.
Take care. Thank you, all of you guys, for a fantastic discussion.
Bye.
From all of us at IIM.
Okay, questions?
No, I think we're out of time, unfortunately. So I think we'll stop the session here.
There was one question, but I think we can answer it later.
Yeah.
Okay, I think anyway, they want us to leave the stage because they got another question. Somebody going on. Okay, bye. Okay, bye, guys. It was good fun talking to you all. Thank you.
Yeah,
bye.
Thank you so much, guys.
Thanks, everyone.
A huge thank you to our sponsors and all our attendees for helping us make this session what it was. And we'll see you in the next session. Thank you.